This is the World According to Zig podcast for May 5th, 2019. My name is John Ziegler. I'm the host of the show where you can still get the truth about the news of the day from a conservative perspective in this world turned upside down. Our website is freespeechbroadcasting.com. That's where you can find all of the past episodes of the podcast, as well as most of the articles that I write for Mediate to keep you up to date on everything that's going on in the world. Much of that has to do with, obviously, the Trump administration. And that is why I need to mention that if you are interested in the latest news regarding President Trump, make sure you check out our other podcasts, which we do biweekly, usually on Sundays and on Wednesdays. You can find that by going to freespeechbroadcasting.com and clicking on the link there, or you can go to my Twitter page or the Twitter page of that particular podcast, which is Individual, the number one pod. There's lots of other things to talk about, though, including an update on what's going on with the Leaving Neverland HBO fake documentary, which we have been chronicling for the last several weeks, almost 2 months now. And actually, not quite 2 months. It just feels like it's been it's been 2 months. My gosh, it really has been 2 months. Wow. Time flies. But it's been 2 months, and we've done a lot of shows on Leaving Neverland, and there's some good news, actually, on that front. Number one, the interview that we aired in its entirety with Michael Jackson's criminal defense attorney, Tom Mesro, on last week's podcast, which if you have not yet heard it, I urge you to check out. That on YouTube, the portion that we put on YouTube, which is only about two-thirds of it, now has 110,000 views on YouTube, which is pretty amazing because, to my knowledge, there's not been one media article about this. This is purely organic social media and people who are interested in the truth of what really happened with that fake documentary who have been spreading this and are very interested in what I believe to be the truth and what I think the facts back up as the truth. So you can check that out. Like I said, the entire interview, 47 minutes, is on last week's episode of the World According to Zig podcast, and there is that video portion, which is on YouTube. Now, last week, I mentioned, and this was not known at the time of the taping, that there was a vote being taken by a local elementary school or middle school here in the Los Angeles area as to whether or not to keep Michael Jackson's name on an auditorium there. Now, Michael Jackson had very briefly attended this school. And what was interesting about this was that they were, instead of making an actual decision, they were going to leave this up to a vote, apparently among staff members of the school. And I think parents also had a say in this vote. And this made me very nervous because, let's face it, academia in general is incredibly politically correct. Virtue signaling is everything. We're talking about sex abuse allegations against people who are alleging that they were basically the same age as the kids that go to the school. And one other interesting thing I did not know at the time is that it wasn't just Michael Jackson who attended that school. One of those who also attended that school was Wade Robson, who was one of the two accusers in the Leaving Neverland fake documentary on HBO. And had I known that, I think my analysis would have been slightly different. And certainly, I think it's relevant when you consider the fact that, as it turns out, Michael Jackson ended up winning the vote. It was announced just hours after we did last week's podcast. And I was mildly surprised and very happy about that because, again, I've just become conditioned to believing that the truth almost never wins in any controversy. Justice almost never prevails. No one's ever going to do the thing that is right or requires any courage at all because courage is dead. Principles don't seem to matter, and everyone just wants to get along and not be criticized. But the fact that Wade Robson went to this school, I think, is really key. And while it probably doesn't end the story, certainly if it had gone in the reverse, I referred to this as a potential contagion. You know, once people start taking down names and statues and what have you, it never ends because now everyone else who has the inclination to do that has cover for doing so. Oh, well, my gosh, a school that Michael Jackson attended in Los Angeles took down his name. So you know, we can't do X, Y, or Z, or we need to end this or that. So that didn't happen. That's the good part. But the why this is even more significant than I thought at the time is that having Wade Robson going there tells you a couple of things. One, this school had even more reason to vote to take down Michael Jackson's name because, after all, one of the two accusers attended there for a longer period of time than Michael Jackson did. But the really interesting thing, and this is purely speculation on my part, but I think it's informed speculation, is that let's do the logic here. Wade Robson is in his 30s, all right? So he attended this school 20, 25 years ago, all right? That means that there are still staff members who were at the school when Wade Robson attended who are there now. Now, my wife is a school teacher, so she's an expert in the way that gossip works around a school, and it only takes two, maybe three staff members who remember Wade Robson and who spread the word among the other teachers, look, I'm not so sure about this kid. This story doesn't seem to make a lot of sense. He certainly never seemed to me like he was abused, and all I remember him talking about was how great Michael Jackson was. That's all it takes. And then that means that the rest of the staff is going to be far, far less inclined to go along with a vote like this, especially when, you know, let's face it, there's still a lot of Michael Jackson fans. It will cost some money for the school to remove the name from the auditorium. And, you know, the criticism that we're going to take, while it might be somewhat significant, isn't going to be that big of a deal. My understanding, although I don't have the final tally, is that the vote wasn't even that close. Which then goes also to my theory that somebody there remembers Wade Robson and is going to say, really? Ah, come on. I'm not sure I'm really buying this. I mean, or maybe it was even more emphatic than that.
You cannot be serious!
I don't know. Maybe there were a couple of teachers there who felt rather impassioned that Wade Robson was not somebody that we should be hanging our hat on. Here with regard to removing Michael Jackson's name from the auditorium. So that was good news, and that, I think, bodes well for the future of the damage of leaving Neverland being at least somewhat mitigated. Oprah Winfrey, as I've always said, is the key to this whole thing. If it wasn't for Oprah Winfrey, none of this would be happening. If it wasn't for Oprah Winfrey, leaving Neverland would not have a force field of protection in the United States of America. That force field doesn't exist strongly in Europe, where Oprah doesn't have nearly the same cachet. But in the United States of America, the media takes all their cues from Oprah. You don't buck Oprah. She's considered to be a patron saint. And so because Oprah Winfrey blessed this whole fiasco and sanctified the accusers, there's been no scrutiny of them at all in this country, other than by people like me, and I'm not even sure who else other than me, maybe a couple other people in the United States, but not very many. And so Oprah really is the whole deal here. And Oprah did an interview with a Hollywood Reporter this week, which I found fascinating. And if you read between the lines, I think is an indication that even she knows this whole thing's a fraud. The first thing she said to the Hollywood Reporter, and apparently this interview was not taped. If it was taped, there was not a tape of it that was released that I saw. It would appear to be an interview that was simply, you know, old-fashioned, verbal, and the transcript was released. And at one point, Oprah Winfrey actually says, somewhat rhetorically, I wonder to myself why I did this. In other words, why I got involved with leaving Neverland. Which certainly sounds like someone who's regretting their actions. Like, maybe this was a mistake on my part. Now, to the credit of the interviewer, who didn't do a very good job with the interview, but heck, nobody in the media does any good jobs with interviews because they're, you know, most people in the media, they're not very smart. Let's face it, they're
idiots! Imbeciles!
And they certainly don't care about getting to the truth, and they're certainly not going to make Oprah look bad because they're just thrilled to get the interview with Oprah Winfrey. But they did ask the question, so do you regret your participation in leaving Neverland? And of course, Oprah said no to that. But then she goes into what she calls the hateration that she has received. And this really drives me crazy. the hateration that she's received for taking this stance on behalf of the movie. And she even, and this is really insulting on so many levels, but of course Oprah gets away with it because she gets no scrutiny. She even related the quote-unquote hateration she's gotten for supporting Leaving Neverland to what she got when she was part of Ellen DeGeneres coming out on her sitcom many, many years ago as being gay. And so that because she sanctified that, she got a lot of backlash. And that was the most quote-unquote hateration that she had received, at least until Leaving Neverland. Well, first of all, it is a huge difference between vouching for someone and being part of a historic event where the first major star in a sitcom comes out as being gay and sanctifying two accusers who have no corroboration, accusing someone else of a crime who's dead, who can't even defend themselves. Those are two totally different things. Yet in her mind, they're the same because, wow, I'm getting criticism. And I'm awfully insecure for a person who's a billionaire and world famous. You would think that you understand that comes with the territory. But in her mind, hateration discredits those who are criticizing. And this is the part that drives me bananas. I see this all the time on Twitter, people who criticize unpopular beliefs that they don't understand, don't have the facts for, as truthers. And you're just a member of a cult. You're like 9/11 truthers, or you're, you know, like Trump cult members. You don't accept the truth, and so you're just hating on me because I'm telling you a truth that you don't want to hear. That happens, but that's not happening here. And hateration is not proof that you're on the right side. It's proof that there are a lot of people who disagree with you. Now, why are they disagreeing with you? Are they disagreeing with you based on facts, or is it based on emotion? And in my experience, this has all been based on almost all on facts and logic and not on emotion. So that was really infuriating that Oprah relied on the hateration. I mean, if this was really a situation where she was in the right, she would be able to cite chapter and verse. No, here's why I did this. I did this because of this factor, that factor, or this presumption or assumption or conclusion that I came to based upon the factual record. There's none of that. None. It's all I've gotten hate, so I must be on the side of right because that's the way these things work. And then there's the statement that, to me, proves that she doesn't really believe the allegations, or at least knows that they're nowhere near credible or proven. And that is that she makes this bogus argument, which she's done in the past. She and Wade Robson, she even says that this is not about Michael Jackson. Huh? What? This is not about Michael Jackson. This is bigger than Michael Jackson. This is about the topic of sex. What do you mean this is not about Michael Jackson?
It's just flat out ridiculous.
I mean, this is all about Michael Jackson. If this was not about Michael Jackson, no one would give a shit. There would be no HBO documentary. You would not be involved. These are allegations that have huge impact on the legacy of a dead man and who cannot defend himself and who was found not guilty unanimously in a court of law where the allegations against him disintegrated. And frankly, this Leaving Neverland thing makes me even more confident that this isn't really the truth and that you're trying to come up with a rationalization for why you did this. Even if we're not right about Michael, we're still doing good because we're promoting the cause of people telling their truths about sex abuse, even though it's not the truth. There is only one truth. You know that, folks, right? There is only one truth. Inherently credible. A film that is made by a guy with an obvious agenda, that ought to matter. But apparently in Oprah's world, it doesn't. So it's okay in her world, I guess, to accuse people of things there's no evidence that they did if you think that it furthers the greater good. And by the way, the greater good in this world might be herself. That's the biggest bunch of crap about the whole thing. Is that there's an indication to me that the person who really benefited here was her, and that's why she participated in this, because of the politics involved in this, the corporate politics involved in this. So that was the Oprah Winfrey interview, which I found to be quite telling if you read between the lines, but of course no one in the media does, because they all worship Oprah and they're all a bunch of morons. Finally, yesterday was May the 4th, which I had no idea until now is known as Star Wars Day. The reason why I know this is Star Wars Day is because suddenly and quite without preparation or warning, my 6-year-old, soon to be 7-year-old daughter, Grace, has turned into a Star Wars fanatic. You remember Grace.
Is Trump a bad guy or a good guy?
That was when she was an innocent little girl, probably about 3 years old, who was still into Disney princesses. Well, technically, she's still into Disney, but she's now graduated from princesses, although technically there's still a princess involved in Princess Leia. But now she's all into Star Wars. And yesterday being May the 4th, and it's May the 4th be with you. Ha ha, hee hee. Yeah, there we go. All of a sudden now, I mean, our world has completely changed in just a couple of weeks. I mean, 3 weeks ago, I don't think Grace knew Han Solo from Luke Skywalker. I don't think she did. And now, yesterday, and you can check this out, I urge you to do so at my Twitter feed, Sigmund Freud, or on my Facebook page. Yesterday, she got a costume, a really cool, super cool costume of Darth Vader. This was as cool as it gets. I mean, my gosh, I was not even a Star Wars fan when I was a kid. But if I had gotten this Darth Vader costume when I was her age, I would have shit myself. And you know, she enjoyed it, and we made a little video of her in the costume, which you can find at, like I said, our Twitter handle at Sigmund Freud, or on my Facebook page. But she is now all in. I mean, in just 3 weeks, she's gone from completely in on Disney princesses to now all in on Star Wars. And it's a little disturbing because, one, it's, you know, it's a little sad to see your kid going through the stages so quickly and realizing, being a teenager is right around the corner. This thing is almost over with. And little Grace is gone now. And now we're just holding on to last vestiges. There's still some vestiges. She's in a very weird stage because, I mean, like, she'll still watch Mickey Mouse Clubhouse occasionally, especially since her little sister, 2-year-old Diana, is very, very, very much into Mickey Mouse Clubhouse. So she'll still watch that from time to time. But now she's totally obsessed with Star Wars to the point where she's watched the, you know, episodes 4, 5, and 6, which were the first three. Go figure that one out. I've never been able to understand that. But now she's starting to get on the ones that got made after the original three, the ones that made Star Wars famous, episodes 4, 5, and 6. And now I'm having to watch them because, you know, it's on all the time. And I got to tell you, I still don't get the Star Wars deal. I just do not get it. Apparently, George Lucas didn't even get the Star Wars deal. Apparently, George Lucas thought that the original Star Wars was going to be a mad flop. And I can understand why, because it sucks. I mean, it sucks in every possible way. I mean, even the special effects are terrible. It's almost like a cartoon movie. But look, I get that it's a cult. I get that people love it. If it gives you enjoyment, fine, fantastic. I don't understand it, but now I have to live with it because this is probably something that's never going away. Unlike the Disney princesses, people don't grow out of Star Wars. So now I'm now having to readjust my entire life for the next 10, 15 years based upon where Grace is going with this whole Star Wars thing because she is in and it is deep. You know, her 7th birthday is coming up at the start of June, so maybe we'll get her back in for her bi-yearly interview and understand exactly how and why this Star Wars obsession has happened. She's still into the princesses. Like I said, she loves Princess Leia and Rey, she loves, but she also loves that Darth Vader costume. Of course, she's scarier than Darth Vader to me at times. I've seen Grace Ziegler be far scarier than Darth Vader. Even in that Darth Vader costume. So check that out if you get a chance. who is this? Who is this? No, I'm your father. You're not my father. Who is this? Wow, it's Darth Vader. But, oh, wait a minute. No, it's Grace Ziegler. You know what I should have known?
What?
Because I don't think Darth Vader wears sandals like that. Why are you wearing this, Grace?
Because I love Star Wars.
And today is the May 4th. May the 4th be with you, right?
Yeah.
You're a Star Wars fanatic, huh? Uh-huh. When did that happen?
Since Mom bought me the Rey costume.
Sometimes you are like Darth Vader, I have to admit.
How dare you?
Let's hear some more Darth Vader.
Okay. You call me.
No, you don't want us to hear more Darth Vader?
You're definitely
the prettiest Darth Vader I've ever seen.
A girl Darth Vader.
A girl Darth Vader. But I've seen the evil in you. And it's probably scarier than Darth Vader. Can I hear some more Darth Vader?
Okay.
The Force is strong in this one. Alright. Pretty cool, huh? Don't estimate the power of the dark side. Alright. Say bye.
Bye.
Hi, Diana.
Thank you.
Oh, Diana's not happy.
She felt left out.
Left out.